My name is Eric Clayton, Diesel Dog Kennels. I'm originally from Michigan, born and raised. The dog community in Michigan is homegrown people. They don't get out much. You don't get necessarily the support you need. The dog trainers for the kind of things that we wanted to get into and do with our dogs, because we consider them a working breed and want to do more than just fill shelters and pump out puppies with breedings and things like that. We needed to find a place to where the community was larger. There was people actively doing things, and California fit our needs. It made sense to make that change, to try and, you know, advance my life, advance the dog's life, do something better than just be a dog breeder. You know, I've produced dogs that have worked, gone to different homes, catching coyotes, hunting hogs, doing different things like that. But I wanted to get into more sports-related activities, become a better dog handler, not just a pet dog trainer. What better place than Southern California? Train dogs year-round. The community is as large as it can get. Ra's the first paper dog I've worked with. He was the first dog I showed. He's who I champed out. He's who pretty much spent every waking moment with me since I got him at 9 weeks old in 2007. He's been a best friend, a vet, a companion, a pillow. I mean, anything that will get me through the night at sometimes. Ra has been with me through October 15th, 2010. I had a house fire, and I lost the first breeding I ever did with him. All 9 out of 10 puppies passed away in the fire with the mother. He took it same way I did, hard. The dude would sit out by their graves when I buried them and just sit there and lay there and hang out. He knew what was going on. He knew what was there. He'd sit by the old building and just stare off. And it definitely made me understand that he was just more than a dog. So that's pretty much part of the reason he is the basis for everything I do. His grandson is my new project. He's the youngest dog in the kennel at 14 months on the 18th, and he is ruffian content. He's watchdog, and he's razor's edge. Not a lot of what most people think you would be working with in a working dog, but he will be what I try to put into maybe some French ring sports, maybe some protection work. He's the razor's edge portion of my kennel. A lot of people don't expect that. They don't believe it when they see him. He is a taller, lengthier, leaner dog and shows more of what people would think of as a pit bull. If you use scientific words, the phenotype is what his appearance is, and he does carry the traits of a pit bull as opposed to a bully. His father, it was a conditioned 118-pound working dog, weight pull, hogs, different various animals. He will be a very large dog when he finishes out and fills out, and he will be something I'm proud of already, but I have high expectations for him, the blood I'm working with, and he will be a large portion of this program moving forward. The blood basis behind my program all at some point reverts back to or stems to Ruffian blood. Ruffian blood comes back to, depending on how far you want to trace it and follow it, Tudor's dogs. And as we know the history behind those dogs, they were generally used for a box. Athleticism, and by box I mean dog fighting, and it's not something I get down with, I promote, but I understand the history. I can respect the time that the people put into it, but it's just not something that I feel at this day and age should be acceptable. It's just what it is. But that blood carries on through years and years and years of this man's dedication. Some people consider it a pit bull. Some people consider it an Amstaff. When you look at it genetically, a pit bull and an Amstaff to a guy like me that has a science base through college is the exact same dog. Different features, bred a different way, but it still comes back to a pit bull. And the blood behind him, he's the result of an outcross breeding, so he's part ruffian and part watchdog blood. His watchdog blood strain, after research and everything, I've learned that it's more bulldog based. So I get a dog that's not necessarily your classic Amstaff or pit bull type, but it's got slightly exaggerated features, but not so overly done to where it's accepted by the bully community. An XL bully for me is a dog that provides exaggerated features to a point, maybe a larger head, extra muscle, maybe more bone, things like that. I like the classic pit bull, the American pit bull terrier for some. But I like a dog that's maybe not necessarily as aggressive towards other dogs, like the DA that comes along with it. Maybe a little bit more, I don't want to say friendly, because the pit bull is a very friendly dog and it's great with people and around things, but just something that can be a little bit more social with your family, companions, with other friends' dogs, things like that, hang out a little bit. My style XL is exaggerated muscle, like so much muscle to where it doesn't reduce the athleticism, but it definitely gives it a little bit more of a freakier look, something that you can see and look at and be like, man, that dog works out, the genetics behind it, it's something else, it's not necessarily typically what you see. That's my style at XL. There's not really necessarily a place for the XL bully anymore in this day and age, because somebody wants something exotic or extreme or so exaggerated that they lose track of health and functionability and movement of the dog. And what really is behind these dogs is working breeds, guardian breeds, bulldogs, mastiffs, pit bulls, things like that. And in my belief, you cannot intermix those types of breeds and just come up with a companion breed that you expect to be chill and sit on your couch and not have a job. With our dogs, we've shown over the years, specifically the last three, got out there, tried to give a little bit more recognition for our dogs and the breed itself. And even though we don't necessarily fit within the full ABKC standard, because our dogs aren't necessarily as blocky or as bulldog or have some of the shorter muzzle features, we got this boy right down here who I took and showed over three shows, and he champed as fast as possible, and he could have probably champed quicker with female competition, but within the XL community it's kind of hard because people do not come out as much because there's not as much support in this day and age because they're not as freaky. And so with not filling the role or the need of what the bully community wants, we still managed to get out, show him, champ him out in a quick period of time. When you look at Rod now, you'll see him to where I keep him around 90 pounds, give or take, 21 and a half inches tall, not necessarily the bulliest features. When I took him to dog shows, he was right around 104, 106 pounds, not as conditioned, a little bit chunkier, you know, didn't carry the muscle that I liked. And that's pretty much what was recognized within the bully community. And the whole time I'm walking my dog around that I feed, I take care of, I love, I enjoy, I'm looking at him like he's fat, and I can't wait to get through our target goal to where I can get him home and get some weight back off of him to where he has more function and more of a dog that I like and that what suits my needs. My dogs have a tendency to stay leaner than what most people like. I like it until they get older, the basis of around our program for what we do. And there's some praise we get, some ridicule, but anybody that knows me and knows Diesel Dogs, we health test everything here and try to work with mostly health-tested animals, not because we're better, but because we've made plenty of mistakes working with untested animals, purchasing dogs in the past from people that didn't health test and do things like that. And I have no problem admitting it came back to bite us, you know. We didn't get the performance that we wanted or the longevity out of the dog, so we had to change something instead of just continuously going through dogs or saying that we were going to be a working kennel and have a bunch of dogs that couldn't handle the stress or even physically the work that we were wanting to put them through. Even activities of just maybe hitting a spring pole or chasing a four-wheeler or a snowmobile for extended periods of time and not having the endurance, the conditioning, or the physical ability to handle it. So my dogs up until about 2 years of age pretty much carry minimal weight. They look really lean, kind of gamey, lengthy, some will say greyhound, lurcher, different types of larger breed dogs that are lean and long. And I have no problem with that because at the end of the day, I'm concerned with what the x-rays, what the blood work says, not an opinion of somebody that's not feeding these dogs. At the end of the day, I take care of them, I feed them, and I want them to be as healthy as possible and be here as long as I can expect. Rob will be 8 in September, and I hope to God this dog lives another 8 years. If he doesn't, I'm going to be very disappointed to lose a best friend. pretty much what we're doing here is we're just trying to give the best, healthiest working dog atmosphere we can give them and make them a complete and round dog over here at Diesel Dogs. So thank you for checking us out. Thanks to Zeke at Bully Badass TV, and thanks again for watching our video. Get it.